Hello everyone. So today we are going to study about the highway geometric design, and this lecture is focused on the cross section elements. Now if we have observed in our like daily life that the road network is never like have a very uniform layout or design or size. We have a road network that vary in shape, that vary in gradients, that vary in dimension. So all these parameters like dimensions, layout, alignments, this comes under geometric design. And the ultimate aim of the geometric design is to optimize the efficiency, so as to construct road network that requires the minimum cost and gives you the maximum output. Now this geometric design depends upon the number of parameters. It depends upon the design speed, it depends upon the topography of the region, depends upon the traffic factors, depends upon the design hourly traffic volume and traffic capacity. So basically your traffic volume is the number of vehicles that pass a section of road per unit time, and same is the traffic capacity with respect to road. We are going to discuss about these in the upcoming section when we proceed with the lectures, but for now your traffic volume or traffic capacity is number of vehicles passing a section of road per unit time. So basically in a road section, the total number of vehicles that are passing, so per unit time, let's say for 1 hour. And this is this traffic volume and traffic capacity is basically comes under traffic survey. So we do the traffic survey and we find out the number of vehicles that are passing in a unit time, and we see the overall requirement of the area. Should the road be multi lane or a single lane, what type of vehicles that are passing, and based upon that the overall width of the pavement is decided. And then we have a variety of environmental factors, right? So all these things comes under geometric design, right? Because topography again plays a very important role in the designing of the geometric design of the road. Because if suppose in this area where we have both the decreasing and increasing gradient, and if we went for the designing of a straight road in this type of topography, then a lot of filling and lot of cutting in the area would have required, that would have cost a lot of time and money, and would have eventually made the project most uneconomical, right? So the cost benefit ratio of the overall construction of road is to be keep in mind when we go for the construction of the road. Likewise, same construction of straight road would have been the shortest path, but the overall project would have been more uneconomical, and this would have compromised the cost benefit scenario. Okay, so these are the parameters on which the geometric design depends. The elements or the components of a geometric design is cross section element, and your cross section element includes width of the pavement, formation and the land surface characteristics, and the cross slope of the pavement itself. Apart from that, the other elements are side distance consideration, that is the visibility aspect in the road section, the horizontal alignment, vertical alignment and the intersection elements. So now let's discuss about the highway cross section elements. The first is your friction. And friction plays a very important role. It governs the operating speed of the vehicle, it governs the acceleration and de-acceleration speed of the vehicle. And as per the IRC, that is Indian Road Congress, the standard code that defines the specification for a certain road, a certain type of road, and the alignment and the provisions for the road. So the IRC suggests that the coefficient of longitudinal friction is taken as 0.35 to 0.4, and coefficient of lateral friction is taken as 0.15. So your longitudinal friction, that is along the length of the road, longitudinal friction along the length of the road is taken as 0.35 to 0.4, while your lateral friction, your lateral friction is this one, your lateral friction is taken as 0.15 as per IRC guideline. Now there are two terms, skidding and slipping, that you must have used or heard at some point of your life, that the vehicle has skid or the slip of the vehicle has taken place. Normally this skidding and slipping is used as an interchangeable term, but this is not the thing, not the scenario. The skidding is different and slipping is different, and the knowledge of these terms, that what is skidding and what is slipping, is very important, especially when we go for the accidental analysis. Suppose you have constructed a road and the road has a curve, and after the construction of the road, suppose a lot of accident happens along a certain section of the road. Investigation is done at the desired point so as to find out the reason for the accidents, and during that it is very important to know if the accident, the collisions or the accidents that are happening, is due to skidding or due to slipping, because based upon the reason, based upon the phenomena of accident, the desired measurement or the desired mitigation techniques can be installed. Alright, so it is very important to know what is skidding and what is slipping. So your skidding is defined as when the path traveled along the road surface is more than the circumferential movement of the vehicle due to friction. Okay, let's just go through it again. Your skidding is defined as the path traveled along the road surface is more than the circumferential movement of the vehicle due to friction. This means that in a road you have vehicles moving. This is a tire that is moving, and because of some obstructions, brakes are applied, and upon the application of the brakes, the distance traveled by the vehicle is more compared to the circumferential movement of the vehicle. So when your tires have come to a halt after the application of brakes, but still there is movement of the vehicle that is taking place, this is called as skidding. Whereas again the same scenario, upon seeing the obstruction, the brakes are applied, but after the application of brakes, the tire revolution is there, but the movement of the vehicle is not there. So this is called as slipping. So slipping is defined as when the wheel revolves more than the corresponding longitudinal movement along the road is called as slipping. The wheel revolves more than the corresponding longitudinal movement. This is your longitudinal movement. After the application of the brakes, you don't have longitudinal movement, but the tire keeps on revolving in its position. This is called as slip. Now the friction and this slipping and skidding scenarios depends upon the type of pavement, that is if you have a rough surface or a smooth surface, and this depends upon the material that you have used, the condition of the pavement. A new pavement, newly built pavement, will have a very good rough textured aggregate, but as the pavement reaches its service life, the quality of aggregate, the roughness of the aggregate get wear out, and it achieves a more and more smooth texture. So it depends upon the condition of the pavement. Then it depends upon the condition of tires. A newly tires have a very good gripping texture, while old tire has a very smooth surface, because of which the grip is compromised to a very large extent. Then of course the speed and the load of the vehicle also affects the slipping, skidding, or the overall friction between the road and the tire. If you have higher speed, then the friction is compromised to a certain extent. As likewise, the same behavior is upon depends upon the load that is on the vehicle. Okay, so like in this we can see that the movement of the tire is not there, but the vehicle is moving in front direction. All right, while here we can see the tire is revolving in its own position, but the movement or the longitudinal movement of the vehicle is not there. All right, so just by yourself guess which one is skidding and which one is slipping. So I hope you have differentiated correctly between the skidding and the slipping. As we can see in this image that the movement of the tire is not there, but longitudinal movement is there. The movement of the tire is not there, but longitudinal movement is there. So this scenario is called as skidding. While in this scenario we see that the movement of tire is there, but longitudinal movement of the tire is not there. So this scenario, that is where the tire is revolving in its own axis, but there is no longitudinal movement. So this is called as slip. Okay, apart from that, the other pavement surface characteristics include pavement unevenness. So a pavement unevenness is the undulations, the potholes, or other irregularities in a section of road. And the more the unevenness is, the more discomfort will be for the passengers that are moving in this section of the road. So we have an unevenness index value of less than 1500 mm per kilometer is considered as a good value. A value less than 2500, that is between 1500 to 2500 mm per kilometer, is taken as satisfactory value. And likewise for 3200 is taken as uncomfortable value, even at a speed of 55 km per hour. Alright, these parameters are for 100 km per hour speed. And then we have another pavement surface characteristic, that is a light reflection, because this plays a very important role, especially in the night. Then the proper drainage facility is another pavement surface characteristic that holds a very important weightage. And it is desired that the pavement should be absolute impermeable, so as to prevent the percolation of seepage of water into the pavement layer. And when we are going to study about the materials, the pavement materials, we are going to study about that the bitumen that is used for the preparation of flexible pavement. Bitumen has a very adverse relationship between the there is a very adverse relationship between bitumen and water, because prolonged exposure of bitumen to water leads to weakening of bonding. Okay, If the bitumen is exposed to water, then the bonding is compromised. So it is very important that the road must have a proper drainage facilities. Next is your cross slope element is camber or cant. So the camber, or also called as cant, it is the cross slope provided to rails middle of the road surface in the transverse direction to drain off rainwater from the road surface. So basically your camber is the minimum slope that is provided so as to allow water to drain off. Okay, so it is the minimum slope that has to be provided, irrespective of even if you are constructing road in a plain area, a minimum slope has to be provided so as to drain off water from the road surface. And the objective for providing cambers are that, of course, surface protection, because whenever you have like potholes in a road and the water accumulates in these potholes, this water basically destroys the bonding of the bitumen and aggregate to which it is in contact, which leads to failure of the that section of the pothole, and this keeps on going on and leads to premature failure of the pavement. Then ember also protects the subgrade, and it also helps in quick drying of the pavement. Now these are the type of cambers that are provided. We have straight camber, we have parabolic cambers, and we have combination of straight and parabolic camber. Okay, the IRC has certain guidelines for the camber for bituminous and concrete pavement. In case of heavy rainfall areas, the camber should be 2%. In case of light rainfall, the minimum camber should be 1.7%. For gravel or waterbound macadam road, we have 3% and 2.5% cambers for heavy rainfall and light rainfall. For earthen road, the value is 4% and 3%. And these value, if you observe, makes sense, because your earth road is nothing but the natural soil, well compacted natural soil, as we were discussing in the previous class. And it is a natural soil. It is of very much importance that whatever the rainfall that is occurring on the earth road, the water should be immediately drained off, because it is nothing but the natural soil. And if the water is allowed to remain on the soil for a prolonged time, then along with it, it will take a certain amount of soil with it, or it will loosen up the bonding between the soil particles, and thus will weak the overall earth road. And the same keeps on the that's why the camber keeps on increasing as the quality or the material of the road decreases. The next element is carriageway width. So carriageway is the roadway that is available for the movement of vehicle. Okay, it is defined as the roadway consisting of a width of the road on which a vehicle is not restricted by any physical barrier or suppression to move laterally. Right, in short, it is the width of the road that is available for the movement of vehicle. So here, this part is called as carriageway. Here the movement of vehicle is allowed, and hence it is called as carriageway. Now we can see that the width of the carriageway, what should be the width of the carriageway, it depends upon the vehicle, width of the vehicle. There has the width of the vehicle, plus we have to maintain a safe distance between the vehicle. So if another vehicle is moving, that if another vehicle is there, then there has to be a certain safe distance between the vehicle, plus there has to be a certain safe distance between the edge of the roads, right? So based upon these parameters, the width of the carriageway decided. So for the single lane road, the average width of the vehicle is taken as 2.44 meter, and a spacing of 0.68 meter is taken as safe gap. So for a single lane road, the width of the carriageway is 3.8 meter. For a double lane road, we have two vehicles that are moving in the road. So 2.44 plus 2.44, then we have gap between the vehicle, this will form 1.06 meter, plus a certain safe distance with the edge, this is taken as 0.53 meters. Okay, so the overall width of the double lane road comes out to be 7 meters. All right, so if you are going for a 3 lane road, 7 plus 3.8 meter. If you are going for 4 lane road, 7 plus 7 meters, and likewise. All right, the next is curb, and we had discussed in brief about the curb when we were talking about the Roman roads. When we talked about the Roman road, the French road, and the British road, we have seen that Romans have used curb so as to provide support for the material that has been put for the construction of the road. So the curb indicates the boundary between the carriageway and the shoulder or island or footpath. So basically your curb acts as a separation, between the carriageway and footpath, or carriageway and the shoulders. So this structure, is called as curb. This part. Okay. This is called as curb. So if you see, it separates from the footpath and the carriageway. Now, depending upon the feasibility and the area, the interest of the person in charge, your curb is your curbs are basically divided into 4 categories. You have low or mountable curbs, you have semi barrier curbs, you have barrier curbs, and you have submerged curbs. Your low and mounted curbs are like these. Okay, these are your low or mountable curbs, which act as a separator between the road and the footpath or the shoulder. Then you have semi barrier and barrier curbs. So your semi barrier and barrier barrier curbs, these act as a separation between the different direction of the road. Okay, so these act as a separator between the or act as a divider between the road. So depending upon the height, they are called as semi barrier or barrier curbs. Your barrier curve will have a height of 20 cm, about 20 cm. Your semi barrier will have a height of 15 cm, and likewise. Then you have submerged curves, and submerged curves, as we have seen in the Roman road, that a submerged curve is constructed below the surface, and it acts as a support system for the material that has been put for the construction of road. So we have seen earlier also that if you have a soil subgrade here, then you have quality of aggregates here, different variety of aggregates that are laid upon. So it acts as a retaining wall and gives you the force that has been acted by the material. It helps to counter that force and retains the overall structure of the pavement. Then the next is right of ways. Now we have seen that up till now, if we talk about the road system, we have studied that a road will have a carriageway. That is used by the vehicles to travel. We have also seen that there is a curb, and then there is shoulder. Up till now we have studied at this much, right? Now you see, the pavement has been constructed in overall this area, right? This is the area in which the pavement has been constructed. So your right of way is the actual area, the land that is acquired for the road and construction of road alignment. Right now this is straight road, otherwise you must have seen that there are certain curves that are included in the design element of the road, and that again occupies a certain section of the land. So whatever the land or the width of the land that has been acquired for the construction of the road and the related parameters, that comes under right of way, right? And this right of way should be adequate to accommodate all the cross section elements of the highway. So during the designing phase, the designing has to be such an with such an accuracy, and based upon that accurate assessment, we come up that a certain section of the land has to be acquired, and then the desired party either buys the land or there is the necessary procedure to acquire the land. Okay, so this is a cross section element. We have carriageway, we have shoulders, then of course there is certain margin that has been, that is left. There is provision for plantation of trees, because now even in the codes also the provision of installation of trees has been taken. So the space also need to be accounted. This again shows the right of way. So the original road is this much, right? If you see, the carriageway basically is this much, but a right of way is this much. This is your right of way, and here footpath, sidewalks or some other provision has been installed. Likewise, your right of way basically covers everything that requires for the construction of road, the overall turning movement and everything. Okay, so your right of way is the width of land acquired for the road and the required alignment that is required. So overall land comes under right of way. So it is very easy to understand what are the governing factors. Width of formation, right? So it depends upon the type of road that you are going for. If you are going for a local road, you are going for arterial road, you are going for state highway, you are going for national highways, expressways. Depending upon the type of road network that you are going for construction of the type of road, the width has to be identified, and based upon that the right of way will be judged. Then height of embankment or the depth of cutting, it depends upon the topography, because as we have seen in the first image that the area or the topography varies from place to place. We have different type of topography in different regions. So based upon the type of topography, we have to judge the most feasible and most economical as well as efficient method for construction of road, and this again governs the overall area of the land that has to be acquired. Then the slight slope, again the slope depends upon the method that will require minimum time and minimum cost and will give you the efficient result. So For example, if you have a very undulated land, in this type of undulated land area, we cannot just go for construction of a straight road, right? Because then we have to fill up the entire area to that level, right? So instead we come up with some middle ground that middle ground required a certain amount of filling and certain amount of cutting, right? And this depends upon the slope and all. Then the side distance consideration. So side distance, we are going to study about this side distance parameters and consideration in the upcoming lectures in a very detailed manner. So your side distance plays a very important role, especially when we are constructing like when we are going for like curved road. So, and this curved road has been blocked by a certain obstacle like vegetation. So we have to ensure that the alignment is such that the vehicle that is coming from this direction and the vehicle coming from this direction see each other or notice each other coming and decrease their speed and position themselves for the safe passage of each one, right? That again comes under the designing criteria. So based upon this scenario, side distance, we have to acquire the land. Then we have to take up certain amount of land for future widening. If because in future the population or the number of people that are going to use that road network will increase. So we have to take in this also in consideration, and taking all these parameters into in mind, we have to find out the total land that has to be acquired. Then the last thing is road margins. Your road margin include shoulders, parking lanes, bus bays, service road, cycle track and footpath. These are like very easy and self-explanatory, right? Parking lanes, the side of the road that are reserved for parking of the vehicles, for stopping of the bus, we have bus bays. For service roads, for other purposes, we have service road, we have cycle tracks, and we have footpath. Shoulder is like a term that need a brief explanation. So along the road, we provide shoulders. Now the shoulders are used, can be, these are like extra width that is provided in the road, and the role of the shoulder is to first of all provide pathway for other commuters or the lightweight vehicles or like cycle to use the road safely. So this area will be used by the traffic, and this area can be used by the cycles. Likewise, suppose in case of emergency, so in case of emergency, ambulance need to pass in a very rapid way. So in that scenario, again the shoulders are used. So we have normal traffic going on here, and the ambulance can just use the shoulders to reach to its desired destination. Likewise, if the vehicle suffers some fault, for temporary purpose, it can park the itself in the shoulders, right? So your shoulders are provided along the road edges and is intended for accommodation of stopped vehicles, serve as an emergency lane for the vehicles, and to provide certain lateral space for other commuters to other commuters to use that same route. Now you have hard shoulders and just normal shoulders. So your hard shoulders is a term that is used for the shoulders that doesn't have much of the spacing. So these are your hard shoulders. Okay, The other point of folder is that it can be used for the overtaking of the vehicle. So that's another thing we are going to discuss as we move on with the lectures. Now the hard shoulders are just a minimum shoulder that is provided because of the lack of space. The minimum width of the shoulder is provided. So these are called as hard shoulders. And when we have sufficient amount of space that is provided, these are called as shoulders. Just normally shoulders. Okay. And the rest is self-explanatory. Then there are certain other margins that are used along the highway. Some control lines are there, and which represent the just to guide the vehicles that are moving in the road section. This also comes under like a cross-section element. Just a brief thing that the various representation of lines and on the road, so as to guide the movement, a smooth movement of the vehicles. Okay, so these are like the markings that are used in a road section so as to guide the vehicles. Okay, so this is about your cross-section element of the road. If you have any doubt, you can ask in the comment section, or if you have any doubt even in the previous lectures, you can ask in the comment section. Okay, thank you.